Would you like to learn how to diagnose and manage one of the most common causes of hospital admission in the US? The answers coming up next.
This is Raj
and Niya with your favorite USMLE channel, where we help you gain in-depth understanding of the high-yield USMLE topics and score phenomenal on the steps.
We're teaching medical content for all steps using our own personally crafted mind maps and algorithm that's gonna make concepts stick.
What you can expect in our videos is a lot of integration, as well as getting a clinical perspective of what's truly important to learn.
Hope you enjoy this video.
Please subscribe to our channel if you haven't already and hit the bell button to receive notifications once we upload new videos.
Thank you for watching.
Heart failure is one of the most common causes of hospital admissions in the United States, if not the most common. So, as you can imagine, it's heavily tested across all steps, and of course, you need to know how to manage these patients when you start your clinical practice. So, in this video, I'll teach you how to diagnose and manage both types of heart failure, with reduced ejection fraction and with preserved ejection fraction. Let's get started. First, let me say a few words about the two types of heart failure before we jump into their management. And let's start with reminding ourselves what was ejection fraction. So, ejection fraction is the amount of blood or the fraction of blood that's been pushed out the left ventricle every time the left ventricle contracts. And why the left ventricle? Because it's the main pumping chamber. So, we have a formula how to calculate ejection fraction, this is the abbreviation, and it is by dividing stroke volume by the end diastolic volume. And stroke volume can be calculated by subtracting the end diastolic volume and the end systolic volume, and then we again divide by end diastolic volume. And what is end diastolic and end systolic volume? The name tells you what it is, right? So end diastolic volume means it refers to the volume that is left in the left ventricle at the end of diastole. And end systolic volume is the volume of blood left in the left ventricle after the end of systole. Now, why do we need to know what is ejection fraction and how to calculate it? Because this is the only way we can differentiate between the two types of heart failure, with preserved and reduced ejection fraction. And what is normal ejection fraction? Normal ejection fraction is 55%. And we'll be using this number a lot today, and we have to remember it. Let's start with heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, also called systolic heart failure or dilated heart failure. And here the ejection fraction will be less than 40%. This is very important to remember. The most common causes include hypertension, the late stages, coronary artery disease, valvular defects, but these and the rest of the causes will be explained at length in the step one heart failure video. Alright, so imagine this is the heart with right ventricle, left ventricle, right atrium, left atrium, and this is the pulmonary system out there. So as you can see, as I have drawn here, the left ventricle is dilated. It's much bigger than the right ventricle, so it's stretched. The end effect is that this left ventricle won't be able to push out the blood forward through the aorta. So what's gonna happen with this blood in the left ventricle? It's gonna back up to the lungs, right? Where the blood is coming from. So imagine the blood is going back to the left atrium, to the pulmonary veins, and here in the pulmonary blood vessels. So if the blood backs up there, the hydrostatic pressure in the blood vessels will increase. And what's gonna happen as a result of this? Fluid will seep out of the blood vessels and will accumulate in the lungs here. All right. So here, by saying this and knowing this and explaining it, we can actually try to explain some of the most common symptoms in heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, which are paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea and ortopnea, right? Alright, so what is paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea? Imagine when you're standing upright, right? This fluid that's been accumulated in the lung is at the base of the lung, right? Because of gravity. But if you lie down, imagine this fluid is taking, let's say, 1/5 of the lung, so you don't have problems breathing. But when you lie down, if this is your lung, this fluid that's in the lung is gonna spread out, right? it's gonna spread out like this, and it's gonna take, let's say, half of the lung, so it will be very, very difficult for you to breathe, right? That's why it's called paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea. When you lie down at night to sleep, you're getting out of breath. That's why people with fluid accumulation in the lung try to sleep with a lot of pillows behind their back, so their lungs can be a little bit in a vertical position, so the fluid, because of gravity, will go back to the base of the lung. And this is called orthopnea. When you're sleeping at night with a lot of pillows behind your back, basically you want to be in a more vertical position because of the reason that I just explained. On the other hand, if the left ventricle cannot contract properly, it won't be able to push the blood forward through the aorta to the rest of the body, thus decreasing the cardiac output. If you decrease the cardiac output, you will decrease the oxygen delivery to your rest of the body, right? To the tissues. So that's how we can explain the symptoms of exertional dyspnea and fatigue. Fatigue especially is the end effect of lactic acid buildup in your muscle because they're forced to use anaerobic glycolysis instead of oxygen. Alright, so these are the reasons why we sometimes call heart failure also congestive heart failure, because of all this congestion of blood in the left ventricle and in the lungs, because the left ventricle has been dilated and it cannot properly contract and push the blood forward. Moving on to heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, and we call it this way because here the ejection fraction is normal or even higher than normal. We also call it diastolic heart failure, hypertrophic heart failure, and restrictive heart failure because of the various reasons that can cause this type of heart failure, which will be explained at length in the step 1 heart failure video. Now here, some of the most common causes are actually infiltrative diseases and hypertension, but here the hypertension, the early stages of hypertension, where the heart is still strong enough and is able to pump the blood against the increased systolic pressure in the periphery. So the end effect will be here the ventricles will hypertrophy, as you can see here, right? So there is more muscle mass here in the ventricles and the lumen is less. Why do we call it diastolic heart failure? Because during diastole, what normally happens is the ventricles fill up with blood. But if here, in our case, if the lumen of the ventricles is so small, they won't be able to fill up with blood properly, right? So depending on which ventricle is mostly affected, we can see different symptoms. If the left ventricle is affected, the blood won't be able to enter the left ventricle and it's going to back up to the lungs. That's why we're going to see pulmonary congestion. If the right ventricle is mostly affected, the blood is going to back up to the right atrium, to the vena cava, etc. That's why we're going to see symptoms like JVD and peripheral edema. And these are the reasons why we sometimes call the heart failure left-sided heart failure and right-sided heart failure. In order to maintain the cardiac output, which by the way is calculated by multiplying the heart rate and the stroke volume, in these patients you can actually notice increased heart rate because they're trying to compensate. And remember, this is happening because here the heart has no problems contracting. It can actually contract with even more force than normal because of all this hypertrophy that's going on. That's why here in these patients you can actually not only observe normal ejection fraction, preserved ejection fraction, but even more than that, higher than the normal ejection fraction, more than 55%. Apart from the patient having heart failure with preserved or reduced ejection fraction, they can present clinically in two different ways. One is for chronic management of their chronic heart failure, and the other one is for acute management of the acute exacerbation or decompensation of the chronic heart failure. Let's see how we manage a patient presenting with acute heart failure, which by the way is most commonly caused by left ventricular systolic or diastolic dysfunction. Now, based on how advanced the heart failure is, the patient can present with different spectrum of symptoms, with which I'm sure you're already familiar with, and some of them we discussed earlier, but let's go over them one more time. Now, the patient can present with dyspnea, which can be acute or exertional. He can have paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea or JVD, which stands for jugular venous distension. He can have orthopnea also, peripheral edema, pulmonary crackles, rails, and wheezes. Now, when you hear the word wheezes, what are you thinking of immediately? asthma, right? Now, because here the heart failure is causing the wheezes, that's why we call these symptoms as cardiac asthma. You can also, of course, see cardiomegaly because of the left ventricle being so dilated that it makes the heart looks bigger. On chest x-ray, you can see cephalization of flow. Now, what is cephalization of flow? It means that if you imagine that this is the lung, normally because of gravitational pull, most of the blood flow in the lung when you're standing upright is at the bases, right? Here. But imagine if you have pulmonary edema, the bases are filled with fluid. Alright? So now the blood flow will be focused more on the apex of the lung, right here. That's why we call it cephalization of flow. Cepho from head, so the most blood flow will be at the apex, and this is where the blood exchange will happen because at the bases will be occupied with fluid, all right? Of course, you can see bilateral congestion and the curly B lines. Now on chest ray, you can see these horizontal lines. They look like that. They're very subtle. You have to actually look for them, which is a sign of interstitial edema again. And of course, ST gallop. Now, ST gallop is a ventricular gallop and is caused by a ventricular overload. Okay, so if you imagine now here, let's draw something, I'll show you. If this is S1, this is S2. S1, by the way, is caused by the closing of the mitral and tricuspid valve, right? S2 is caused by the closing of the aortic and pulmonary valve. And this is S1 again. Now, between S1 and S2 is systole, right? And between S2 and S1 is diastole. All right, now, S3, where are you gonna hear it? It's an early diastolic sound, so basically right after the S2, all right? So this is S3 here. And you can hear it in the mitral area with the stethoscope, with the bell of the stethoscope put in the mitral area while the patient is lying on his left side, basically in the left decubitus position, all right? All right, so by the way, S4 is called atrial gallop, all right? And it's because it's caused by blood flowing through the from the left atrium to the left ventricle into a very stiff ventricle, all right? And S4 is a late diastolic sound, okay? So S4, you're gonna see it here before the S1. Here is S4. So S3 is early diastolic sound and S4 is late diastolic sound. As we said, our patient with acute heart failure can present with acute dyspnea. Now, when you see a patient with acute dyspnea on the boards and on your clinical practice, you should immediately start thinking of the most common differential diagnoses, which include pulmonary edema, asthma exacerbation, pneumothorax, and much less oftenly methemoglobin. But because methemoglobinemia is tested on the boards, let's quickly remind ourselves what was this. So normally in the hemoglobin molecule, the iron is in 2+ form, also called ferric form. In methemoglobin, the iron is in 3+ form, also called ferrous form. Now here, this methemoglobin cannot bind oxygen. So, and whatever oxygen it actually binds, it does not release it to the tissues. It holds to it so tightly. That's why the patient will present with acute dyspnea, hypoxia, also blue discoloration of their skin, along with chocolate brown blood. The most common causes are local or topical anesthetics, certain antibiotics like Dapsone or Trimetoprim, and the antidote is methylene blue. A patient having acute heart failure, regardless of which type of heart failure he's having, is treated the same way. So firstly, you want to start them on furosemide. Furosemide with trade name Lasix is a loop diuretic. It acts on the ascending loop of Henle to block the reabsorption of sodium, potassium, and chloride. So when you block the reabsorption, you basically lose them in the urine. So this is exactly what you want to do. Because these patients are fluid overloaded, you want to lose as much water as possible. And as you lose sodium, sodium drags water with it. Alright, so now the initial dose of furosemide can be calculated in two ways. If the patient is Lasix naive, basically he has never had furosemide before, you can multiply 40 times his creatinine, and this will be your initial dose. whereas in patients who have been taking furosemide, you can multiply 2 × 5 times their home dose, and this will be your initial dose. You can give them Lasix as often as you wish, but the half-life of Lasix is actually 6 hours. And how can you remember this? By the trade name. This is how they came up with it. Last 6 hours, Lasix. And most commonly, the patients are coming with acute exacerbation of their heart failure due to several main reasons, right? Either they drink more than 1 liter of fluids per day, and what 1 liter is the allowed amount of fluids they can take per day, or they are having acute ischemia, or they are not taking their medications, right? Medication non-compliance, or they're having some sort of arrhythmia. Now, apart from furosemide, you want to do a complete physical examination in history to look for possible etiologies. And also keep in mind the side effects of furosemide, which are hypokalemia, hypomagnesemia. So keep check on the patient's electrolytes and keep checking them every so often. So the most severe complication of heart failure, especially the left ventricle heart failure, is pulmonary edema. Why is it happening? Because the left ventricle cannot contract, right? Cannot push the blood forward, so the blood backs up into the lungs and you're ending up with pulmonary edema. Now, pulmonary edema, you want to manage this emergently, right? So you want to give them furosemide again, but you want to add oxygen, morphine, and vasodilators. The most commonly used one is IV nitroglycerin. You can also use nitroprusside and hydralazine, but nitroprusside is not so oftenly used because of cyanide toxicity. And now in the following slide, you can see the most commonly tested points on cyanide toxicity. As we said, these three drugs here are vasodilators and specifically venodilators, and as such they will decrease the preload and along with that the blood pressure. Now this is very important. This is how they're gonna trick you on the exam. They're gonna give you a patient with acute heart failure with pulmonary edema and low blood pressure, and they're gonna ask you what are you gonna give them next. So you do not give them the vasodilators here, but you give them IV inotropes, and you can choose from dobutamine, amrinone, and murinone. Dobutamine actually is beta 1 and beta 2 adrenergic agonists. So the beta 1 receptors in the heart, by stimulating them, dobutamine will increase the contractility of the heart, thus increasing the blood pressure. And beta 2 in the vessels, they will cause vasodilation and thus decreasing the afterload. Okay, so if you remember in the blood vessels real quick, we had three receptors, alpha 1, beta 2, and M3. And from these three, only alpha 1 is the innervated one. So when it's stimulated, it's gonna cause vasoconstriction. Whereas beta 2 and M3 are not innervated, but when stimulated by drugs, will cause vasodilation. Amrinone and murinone are actually phosphodiesterase 3 inhibitors. And as being such, they will increase the intracellular cyclic AMP, they will stimulate the protein kinase A, and in its turn, it's gonna cause increased calcium ion entry into the cardiac cells, along with blocking the calcium sequestration by the sarcoplasmatic reticulum in cardiac cells, and the end effect of course will be increased contractility. They also have mild vasodilative effect. Once you have stabilized your patient, you should perform a transthoracic echocardiography. This is the best initial test to differentiate between the systolic and diastolic heart failure. And again, what was the ejection fraction, which is normal? It's 55%. If it's reduced, you have heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, which is also called systolic heart failure. Whereas if you have 55% ejection fraction or even more, this is called heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, also called diastolic heart failure. Now, if they ask you about the most accurate test to differentiate, right, between the two heart failures, it's MUGA scan. MUGA scan stands for multigated acquisition scan, also called nuclear ventriculography. This test in clinical practice is not so commonly done. Let's say a few words about the BNP here. BNP stands for brain natriuretic peptide, and it's called like this because it was first discovered in extracts of pig's brain. Now, BNP is released by the cardiomyocytes of the ventricles in response to ventricular stretching, when there's a lot of blood volume in the ventricles. and we use the BNP to quickly differentiate between cardiac and pulmonary causes of patients with acute dyspnea. So there was this study which was called BNP study, and they called it the breathing not properly study because of the acute dyspnea the patients were presenting with. So they measured the BNP in different patients. So if a patient with acute dyspnea had the main cause was heart failure, their BNP levels were around 600 nanograms per liter. But if the patient with acute dyspnea, the cause of this dyspnea was non-cardiac causes, the BNP levels were around 50 nanograms per liter. So this study proves that we can actually use the BNP as a quick measurement to figure out in ER settings what is the main cause of the acute dyspnea in this patient. And also keep in mind that the BNP increases with age and decreased renal function, and the BNP decreases with increased BMI. So don't let them fool you on your test, and this is also a very good tip to know for your clinical practice as well. Depending on the ejection fraction, we treat the two types of heart failure in two different ways. So let's see how we manage patients with heart failure with reduced ejection fraction first. As we said before, if the patient comes to you in acute decompensated condition, you're gonna treat him acutely with the therapy that we just discussed. But after you stabilize him, you can start him on a long-term therapy, chronic therapy, with the guideline-directed medical therapy that we have. Some of these drugs have mortality benefit, the other ones are just for symptomatic treatment, and we're going to discuss all of them now. Also, keep in mind that your treatment will be based on the functional class, the New York Heart Association NYHA functional class that your patient is in. And you can see the different classes, the New York Heart Association classes, in the following slide. The first drugs that we are going to discuss that have proven mortality benefit are the ACE inhibitors and the ARBs drugs. Now, the ACE inhibitors, you can actually start the patient on a low dose and keep increasing the dose every day. But on the test and for your clinical practice, if they ask you, is it better to keep increasing the dose of the ACE inhibitors or adding a beta blocker, choose adding a beta blocker. The combination of ACE inhibitors and beta blockers have proven mortality benefit, and it's much better to use them in combination rather than using them alone separately. Now, on top of that, high doses of ACE inhibitors have not proven any mortality benefit. Also, now the ACE inhibitors have side effects, right, that we all know very well. For example, dry mouth and cough. Now, if the patient presents with these two, you can switch him to the ARBs drugs, right, the sartans, olmesartan, candesartan, etc. But if the patient presents with angioedema because of his taking ACE inhibitors, you should not start him on ARBs because the ARBs drugs also cause angioedema. And the newest drug that we have that has proven mortality benefit and that is much better than the ACE inhibitors and the ARBs is called sacubitril valsartan. Sacubitril valsartan is an ARNI drug. ARNI stands for angiotensin receptor neprilysin inhibitor. It acts on both the RAS pathway, which we'll discuss in a bit, and the natriuretic peptides. Let's discuss the RAS system here, as it is super high yield and it's very important for you to know in order to understand the mechanism of action of the drugs that we just discussed. So let's go over it. Now, the RAS system stands for renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system, and its main goal is to increase the blood pressure. Alright, so how does it do it? Firstly, angiotensinogen from the liver gets converted to angiotensin 1. How? With the help of an enzyme, with the help of the enzyme renin. So renin is released from the juxtaglomerular cells, from the afferent arterioles in the glomerulus, in response to decreased blood pressure. So here this step can be blocked by aliskarin. Now all the drugs in red that you see counteract the some of the steps in the RAS system. So the RAS system is trying to increase the blood pressure. Our drugs here in red will try to decrease the blood pressure. Alright, now angiotensin 1 has to be converted to angiotensin 2. How? With another enzyme. The ACE, the famous ACE enzyme. Angiotensin converting enzyme. It's released from the endothelial cells in the lungs. Now, which class drug can block the ACE? the ACE inhibitors, of course, the prio drugs, enalapril, lisinopril, etc. Now keep in mind here that the ACE breaks down bradykinin to inactive metabolites. So if you use ACE inhibitors, they will block this step, right? So you will have a lot of bradykinin, which will ultimately lead to the lot of vasodilation and angioedema. Now it makes sense why the ACE inhibitors cause angioedema, right? Alright, so angiotensin 2 will work on different organs in order to increase the blood pressure. And how does it do it? Via AT1 receptors. So remember, angiotensin 2 works on AT1 receptors. And these AT1 receptors can be blocked by our ARPS drugs, the statins. Alright, so here angiotensin 2 will work on the adrenal gland to release more aldosterone, which will keep the sodium and water in the body, which will cause increase in blood pressure. Also, we work on the kidney to retain more sodium and water, which will again increase the blood pressure. And it will work on the blood vessels by causing vasoconstriction, again leading to increase in blood pressure. Now, we explained the ACE inhibitors and the ARBs, but where is our ARNI drug, the sacubitril valsartan? Now, let's see. Valsartan sounds like our sartan drugs, and it's a sartan drug, alright? But what is sacubitril? It sounds like the ACE drugs, enalapril, lisinopril, etc., but it's not an ACE inhibitor. It's actually neprilysin inhibitor. So neprilysin is an enzyme that breaks down the ANP and BNP, alright? So ANP and BNP are hormones from the natriuretic peptide system that are released from the cardiomyocytes in the heart in response to increased blood pressure. So their main goal is to decrease the blood pressure by vasodilation and increased natriuresis. Now, if our sacubitril here blocks the neprilysin that breaks down ANP and BNP to inactive metabolites, you will end up with decreased blood pressure, right? So again, that's why sacubitril is in red, and that's why all antihypertensive here drugs are in red on the board. The next class we're going to discuss are the beta blockers. The beta blockers have mortality benefit. And remember, the higher the dose of beta blockers, the higher the mortality benefit. Not all of them though have mortality benefit, only three of them. The metoprolol succinate, the extended release one that we give once a day, the carvedilol and the bisoprolol. Also keep in mind that you can increase the dose but over at least 2 weeks. Not like the ACE inhibitors where you can increase the dose every day. And also remember the target heart rate here when using beta blockers is between 55 and 60 beats per minute. The next drug class that has proven mortality benefit is the aldosterone antagonists, the spironolactone and eplerenone. Also keep in mind that here they do not act as diuretics in the doses we use them, and you don't need to know the doses. You can use them in patients with NIHA class 2 to 4. And also keep in mind that because they can cause hyperkalemia and kidney dysfunction, you can only use them in patients with potassium less than 5 mmol per liter and in patients with creatinine less than 2.5 mg per deciliter if they're male and less than 2 mg per deciliter if they're female. The combination hydralazine isosorbide dinitrate also has proven mortality benefit. It's especially beneficial in African American patients. Also, you can use it in patients who fail to improve on all the previous drugs that we discussed, the ACE, ARBs, ARNIs, the beta blockers and aldosterone antagonists. You can also use them in patients with NIHA functional class 3 to 4. The next drug with proven mortality benefit for heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, and by the way very expensive, is ivabradin. Ivabradin is a sodium funny channel blocker, and by blocking this funny channel, it will cause negative chronotropic effect, which means you decrease the heart rate. But more on that in the action potentials video for step 1. If the patient's symptoms fail to improve on the guideline directed medical therapy that we just discussed, you can actually try to relieve his symptoms by using several devices. And the most simplest one is the live vest. Now, live vest you can use it if the ejection fraction is below 35%, and you should use it for a minimum of 3 months while the patient is still on the medical therapy that he's been taking. Now, what is a live vest? It is exactly what it sounds like. It's a vest with electrodes. So the electrodes are constantly attached to your body, and if they detect a life-threatening rhythm, they will deliver a treatment shock. Now, after 3 months of wearing this life vest, you can perform a TTE to check for the ejection fraction. Now, in case where the ejection fraction is still less than 35%, the functional class of the patient is 3 to 4 and the survival expectancy of the patient is more than 1 year, then it's advisable to implant a defibrillator, the so-called ICD, implantable cardioverter defibrillator. So this device will prevent for any arrhythmias and sudden cardiac death, which by the way are the most common causes of death in these patients. The next step, if your patient is still not improving, is to implant a biventricular pacemaker. In order to implant this pacemaker, your patient must meet all of the following criteria. He must have ejection fraction less than 35%, on guideline-directed medical therapy, he has to be in New York Heart Association functional class 3 or 4, and he must have left bundle branch block plus QRS complex more than 150 milliseconds. And if nothing is making your patient better, you should put them on the heart transplant list. And while waiting for the transplant, you should keep them alive somehow, probably because they are already in end-stage heart failure. The things you can do is use a left ventricular assisting device, the so-called LVAD, or IV drip of dobutamine or murinone. Now, these drugs increase mortality, but this is the only thing left to do for your patient. Now, if the patient receives a heart transplant, they should be on triple chemotherapy for a minimum of 3 years. Now, we use one calcineurin inhibitor, cyclosporine or tacrolimus, one antiproliferative agent, mycophenolate mofetil, sirolimus or everolimus, and of course prednisone. Now, prednisone you should use for at least 1 year, the first year, because the rejections are highest in the first year. Now, also keep in mind that patients with heart transplant can present with silent MI because it's presumed that the transplanted heart has been denervated, and even if the patient is having acute MI, he won't be able to feel anything. Having said that, don't rush to disregard chest pain as non-cardiac in these patients. And also, the only way to check for rejection in heart transplanted patients is actually cardiac biopsy. Apart from the drugs that have mortality benefit, we have several other drugs that we can use here for symptomatic treatment. These are the furosemide that we already discussed, the calcium channel blockers, some of them, only the dihydropyridines and only the amlodipine and felodipine appear to be safe in heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, and they're used to control symptoms of angina and hypertension in these patients if these symptoms are not controlled by the ACE, ARBs, ARNI and beta blockers. Here you can also use digoxin. Ever since the DITCH trial proved that the use of digoxin in such patients decreases their hospitalization, but unfortunately does not decrease mortality. Here we use it as inotrope to control the symptoms of exercise intolerance, fatigue, dyspnea. Now, keep in mind that digoxin comes with a lot of side effects that you will be tested on all three steps, so make sure you know all of them. In the following slide, you can check out the most commonly tested ones. Some of the off-the-wall questions that you're gonna see on the boards, because they love testing those, sound something like this. Asymptomatic decrease in ejection fraction, or new onset unexplained heart failure. What is it due to? On the boards, look for some chemotherapeutic agent. Board favorite? Trastuzumab. Trastuzumab is a monoclonal antibody. We use it for cancers who are HER2 positive, most commonly breast cancer. It can cause reversible myocardial hibernation. So once you stop trastuzumab, the heart function will go back to normal, so you don't need to treat the patient with anything else. Now, if you combine trastuzumab with some anthracycline, let's say doxorubicin or cyclophosphamide, then the cardiac toxicity as a side effect of the use of this will increase. Apart from that, if you use chronically, long-term, in high doses, doxorubicin alone, also called adriamycin, it can cause irreversible cardiomyocyte fibrosis and necrosis. So keep this in mind. Also, for all newly diagnosed patients with heart failure, you want to perform ischemic workup, all right? And you do this using the TIMI score. Now, the TIMI score, I have talked about this at length in the coronary artery disease video, so you can check it out there. Anemia is also very commonly seen in patients with heart failure. So you can start suspecting iron deficiency anemia if the ferritin is less than 41 nanograms per milliliter and the transferrin saturation is less than 20%. Anemia in these patients actually increases the mortality, so you want to look for it and treat it accordingly. And how do we treat it? Based on studies. The first one is called FAIR-HF. It actually proved that IV iron improves the patient's symptoms, whereas the Iron Out study proved that oral supplementation of iron does not improve the patient's symptoms. So if you want to treat the patient's anemia, always use IV iron. Now, keep in mind that in heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, it's very easy to form a left ventricular thrombus because the blood is stagnant in this left ventricle that is not contracting properly. Here, how do we treat it? With anticoagulation. You treat with warfarin, of course bridged by heparin, until you reach a goal of INR 2 to 3. And also keep in mind that the NOAC drugs cannot be used instead of warfarin. And the NOAC drugs are dabigatran, apixaban, rivaroxaban and endoxaban. We're gonna finish this video with the chronic management of heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. Now, the most common causes of this failure include, again, hypertension in the early stages, diabetes, obstructive sleep apnea, obesity, etc. Now, here, unfortunately, no drug has proven mortality benefit. And what we are trying to do in these patients is control the hypertension and the symptoms as they occur with beta blockers and diuretics. Also, keep in mind that in this failure, because of all this hypertrophy, the ventricles, the lumen of the ventricles is very small. So they are very sensitive to fluid overload. That's why we always counsel our patients to not drink more than 1 liter of fluid per day, so they don't end up in the emergency department with acute exacerbation of their heart failure, as we saw before. As always, it's been a real pleasure to share my knowledge with you. I hope you liked this video and it's been helpful to you. If you have any questions, just leave them in the comment section below. Be curious. Keep asking why. Do not go gentle into that good night. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. See you in the next video.